I'm Mike Farrington. Welcome back to the boardroom. In this video, I'm going to do a quick and dirty restoration of this Delta 16-inch radial arm saw. And let's start off with a shot of the humorously sized saw blade. During the course of this video, in addition to assembling this pile of parts into a working saw, I'm going to share a few of my thoughts on radial arm saws and why I wanted to add one to my shop. I actually ended up buying two radial arm saws. I brought this one home first, only to find that the casting was cracked. This is the main connection point between the two arms that the saw carriage rides on. I was totally bummed when I discovered this, but as luck would have it, the next day another one popped up for sale. This also provided an opportunity for me to compare the two saws. I'm guessing here, but the older one being made in the 50s or so, and the newer one in the late 80s or early 90s, the newer saw used an aluminum block to drive the saw arm up and down, which has significant play. The older saw used a cast bronze piece, zero play, and it spun super smooth. Steel versus brass here. The steel piece is from the newer saw and is already showing wear. The brass is out of the older saw and still has plenty of life left in it. Okay, on to the actual assembly. I'll start with a column. These bolts adjust the clamping force to the column that travels up and down in this tube. These can press the tube open or squeeze it shut, just depending on how the column fits inside. This column is out of the older saw as well. I think this part has some kind of plating on it for durability. The column from the newer saw, it's not too bad, but there are some fingernail catching wear spots. I added some fresh grease to the threaded rod and bolted in place. I think using this part out of the older saw really adds a nice feel when raising and lowering the saw blade. The next few parts are what connect the threaded rod inside the column to the handle on the front of the tool, which raises and lowers the saw blade. First a spacer, then a bearing, then this housing, followed by another bearing. Next is a Woodruff key and bevel gear. If you're going to buy one of these saws for your shop, this is one of the critical areas to check. There can be a lot of force put through these gears if the column isn't lubed well, so this is a common failure point. A castle nut is used to remove any slop, and a cotter pin ensures things won't come loose over time. I couldn't find my hammer, so I used the next closest thing. Now it's time to put this assembly back in the frame. Either I'm a weakling or this sucker is heavy. Also note that it's being bolted into a cast iron piece that's then bolted to the frame. I think this is a really key part to note. It adds a ton of rigidity to the whole structure. Most radial arm saws don't have this, they're just a sheet metal base. Next up is the linkage from the front handle back to the column. The second bevel gear is installed, and I give this little pin a tap, tap, tap-a-roo. And don't worry, I come back later with a punch to drive it home. Time to put the crank back on, and here's another area where Delta cost cut themselves out of business. The newer crank is plastic and feels cheap and sloppy, which is good in some situations. Not this one though. The old one is a nicely machined piece of cast iron and steel. I didn't have the right size roll pin, so a nail punch will do for now. Now that the column is back together, it's time to make some adjustments. First, I install the brass part that I showed earlier. Next is to set the tension between the column and the tube. The feel I'm going for is the least amount of pressure on the column where all play is removed. And this is something that I have to play around with a few times until it's just right. Next, I remove rotational play by tightening these grub screws, which press the brass part against the spine on the column. Same deal here, I just mess around until there's no play and as little drag as possible. The first of two arms is bolted in place. At some point, I picked up this mini forklift thingy. I had no idea how much I would use it. I don't lift anything heavy anymore. I even feed myself cereal with this bad boy, though the forks are not dishwasher safe. Let's take a look at how the miter function works. There's a spring-loaded plunger that references either a 90-degree setting or two 45-degree settings. This bolt locks the saw arm in place and prevents rotation. It pinches the casting around the turret that I showed in the previous shot. The turret goes in, and the second arm is bolted to the bottom of this turret. But before bolting the arm in place, I give the hardened steel rods a bit of buffing with some steel wool. This is a neat system. If one of the rods is damaged, it can be loosened and rotated. These rods are what the saw carriage bearings ride on, which will be shown as the video unfolds before you. There are two locator pins that need to be aligned. After that, it's a simple matter of tightening four bolts and the arm is in place. Here's a quick look at how things are coming along. Last but not least, the miter locator gizmo thingy is shoved back in. The fit was super tight, so I had to use the good old press and wiggle technique. Bearings have grease in them. Grease dries out over time, and oftentimes this dried out grease is mistaken for a bad bearing. So what I like to do is heat the bearing up super hot, and then soak it in some kind of solvent, and oftentimes this will free up any crusties within the bearing. For some extra credit, after the bearings are spinning freely, soak them in some oil to re-lube them. Note this won't work on bearings with rubber seals because the seal would melt from the heat. Since these bearings are what the carriage ride on, having these work smoothly is critical. With the bearings spinning like new, I reinstall them in the saw carriage. Two of the bearings are fixed, and two are mounted on eccentric shafts. This is how slop is removed between the carriage and the saw arm. I add some blue raspberry grease to the bearing plate and bolt it to the main carriage. This connection would allow the saw to rotate for ripping. I don't plan to use this feature, as this saw will be a dedicated cross-cut saw only. I personally think ripping on a radial arm saw is a little too square peg round hole for my liking. Speaking of dedicated crosscut, my plan with this saw is twofold. I'm going to use it as a general crosscut saw, and due to its heft and rigidity, it should be very accurate. Also, I'm planning to use it to help with cutting joinery like dados or half laps. I also have an idea that I'm going to play around with that would be a neat way to cut tenons, and if that works out, I'll share it with you in a future YouTube video. So I'm going to play around with this saw for a few months and see if it performs the way that I hope. If so, I'll keep it. If not, it'll get sold. So I forgot to put the carriage lock on the first time, but after getting the carriage in the arm, I'm pretty happy. Very smooth and no play in any direction. Last tedious task is to get the motor back in. One thing to note, this tool has a single phase motor, which is pretty rare for a saw of this size. Most of these are three phase since they're industrial level tools. Not a huge deal, but three-phase adds another step of having to turn on the phase converter, which is a little annoying. Also, it makes setting up an auto-start dust collection system more difficult. This plunger is what sets the bevel angle of the saw. If I change the bevel angle, I don't think I would rely on this. I would use one of those magnetic digital angle boxes. This is a neat feature. It's a stop to reduce the travel of the saw carriage. Since the stroke is like 30 inches or something, it's nice to be able to reduce that when not needed. So I think this is good for safety. The previous owner set up this wacky welded aluminum deal, which works only with this plunger removed. I'm guessing it was for dust collection, but I didn't have any of the other parts, so I'm going to take this off and build my own. With that out of the way, the saw carriage is now sliding slick as snot. This strikes me as a design flaw, or I don't know what. Even with the rubber bumper in place, which is up out of sight in this shot, the back of the carriage still hits the column first. So I break out my favorite cleaner acetone. Ooh, I'm sorry, I mean acetone. Sorry, I almost mispronounced that. Which is known for its ability to clean project residue. It also happens to be a great band name. The Acetones. Maybe they open for the Deftones. I don't know, you tell me. So I Super 77 a small piece of leather to absorb the impact. This is a very awesome pro tip, by the way. Add leather to your tools. It will soften metal to metal contact, and it will help clamps grip more firmly with less force. From stationary power tools to bar clamps to mallets, get some leather and use it as needed. This is 8 to 9 ounce tool leather for reference. So at this point, we have a working tool, but there are a few things I would like to change. First, the location of the switch. It's not awesome or easy to reach. The older saw had it up on the arm, which is much better. So I'm going to try and come up with a better solution for the current saw. Next, the upper portion of the saw doesn't flex at all. It's inflexible, which in this case is good. However, the steel sheet metal legs are a bit floppy for my liking, so I'm either going to bolt this thing to the wall, or I'll make a cabinet that will act as the base. And I'll leave some space here so I can still pick it up with the mini forklift. So I made some test cuts. It's a little intimidating, and will take some getting used to. A 16-inch blade like creates its own wind pattern when it starts up. But this saw will cut a 6x6 post in one pass, which is great for deck building. And I'm hoping that I can make big cuts which need no additional attention, such as the bottom rail on an entry door, which could be 10 inches wide and 2.5 or more inches thick. So during the test cuts, I realized I needed an auto return for the saw carriage. In the box full of junk and stuff that came with the saw, there was a weight and pulley contraption, which at one point I'm sure was a homebrew auto return. That's cool and all, but I wanted something a little more professional. So I found an OEM Delta auto return on eBay. Yes, that eBay, they are still around. It bolted on quickly, and the guard could still be removed and replaced. Also, the return force could be adjusted simply by turning or clicking, so I'll be able to fine-tune as needed. At this point, I need to build a new table for it, and then do all the final adjustments so that it's cutting perfectly. I'm going to hold off on that until I build my miter saw station, which is forthcoming. Time will tell if this saw and I become BFFs or not, but it was a fun rebuild project. Thanks for watching. Till next time.